1795. Two revolutionary movements are spreading throughout Europe, which will affect the lives and futures of peoples the world over. The first is the French Revolution, now in full swing. The Bastille has been stormed with many deaths. By the time it is over, profound changes will have permanently altered the nature of public authority, government, individual rights, and the power of the church. The second major upheaval is the Industrial Revolution, which is drastically altering the techniques of management, the production of wealth, the formation of capital, and the distribution of products to consumers. Simultaneously, the arts and sciences are undergoing radical changes. The classical and neoclassical period is drawing to a close, and the era of Romanticism is in full flower. It is at this turbulent point in the history of Europe that we first meet the 25-year-old Ludwig van Beethoven, a dynamic new musical personality in that vibrant cultural center of Europe, Vienna. In the 2 years since his arrival from Bonn, he has already made an impression in this sophisticated city. In the world of music, Bach and Mozart are dead. Haydn is 63 years old. Rossini is a child. And other great composers, among them Berlioz, Mendelssohn, and Wagner, will be born before Beethoven reaches his 50th birthday. In the fields of science and philosophy, the rational, empirical, and romantic views are burgeoning. Newton, a century earlier, had laid the foundation for a rational view of the universe. Rousseau had introduced the concept of the natural man, and Locke, his empirical and scientific method. And in literature, Goethe's writings and lyrics clearly reflected the romantic spirit of the time. It was out of this dynamic and tumultuous age, this flourishing of science, art, and new social and political relations, that Beethoven emerged with the power to shape the romantic impulse in music. I am Dr. Victor Goodhill, professor of ear surgery at UCLA School of Medicine, and I should like to share with you some musical and medical thoughts about Ludwig van Beethoven. As a physician and an amateur musician, several aspects of Beethoven's life have long intrigued me. How could a deaf man compose music, and not just ordinary music? How did deaf Beethoven conceive the Ninth Symphony? After more than a century and a half, this tragically puzzling phenomenon is still a mystery. What caused his deafness? How did he respond to this shocking calamity? How could he continue to surpass even his own great compositions with less and less, and finally with little useful hearing? And lastly, what did his own music sound like to his defective ears? How did deaf Beethoven hear Beethoven? Who was Ludwig van Beethoven? Where did he come from? What do we know about his childhood and his family?
Bonn, Germany. On December 16, 1770, Ludwig, the second son of Johann von Beethoven and his wife Maria Magdalena, was born in this house into a musical family. Originally named Louis, he became known as Ludwig while still a child. He was taught music as a youngster, his father forcing him to practice. He was a child prodigy, and in 1778, at age 8, he was taken to Cologne for his first public performance. This advertisement announces the event. And still as a youngster, he was appointed acting organist in Bonn, where he used this organ, and he wrote his first composition, Variations on a March of Dressler, for piano.
His childhood was a tempestuous one, with a frequently drunken father, a quarrelsome home, and forced music lessons. He did not hesitate to share intimate personal and family problems in letters to his friends. He never mentioned a hearing loss in his early years.
Bonn was a very musical and artistic community of less than 10,000. Since Maximilian Friedrich, Archbishop and Elector of Cologne, lived there, in this palace, Bonn was a significant religious and cultural center. At 17, Ludwig first visited Vienna briefly, where he met Mozart for the first time. It was in Bonn that he later met Haydn, and in 1792, Haydn persuaded him to return to Vienna to study with him. A year later, in 1793, at the age of 23, he wrote his opus number one, the Three Piano Trios. He was soon lionized as a brilliant young pianist, playing in the music salons of royal families. His compositions attracted attention, and his contacts with royalty made it possible for him to acquire financial support, a necessity for most artists at that time. His patrons included Count Ferdinand Waldstein, Count Andreas Razumovsky, and the Archduke Rudolf. Although he was then a healthy young man, he had had a number of illnesses. Smallpox had left his face and neck somewhat pockmarked. He had recovered from typhus or typhoid fever, and he was allergic, with episodes of hay fever and asthma.
We can assume that at age 25, Beethoven still had normal hearing. In order to understand his hearing loss, let us briefly look at modern hearing testing methods.
A tone audiogram charts a patient's responses to pure tones, usually tested in octaves. The horizontal lines represent loudness differences in decibels. The vertical lines represent pitch differences in octaves. Conventionally, we use C tones beginning at 250 hertz and ascending in octaves to 8,000 hertz.
These are the tones corresponding to the audiogram which are usually tested. 250, 500, 1,000, 2,000, 4,000, 8,000.
Hearing levels are tested in two ways. First, by patients' responses to air-conducted tones through earphones, and second, by bone-conducted sounds from a vibrator. A normal audiogram would look like this, with zero loss depicted for both air conduction, shown as circles, and bone conduction, shown as X's, for all frequencies. If it had been possible to measure Beethoven's hearing with a modern audiometer, invented some 125 years later, I believe he would have had a normal audiogram for both the left and right ears. That is why the squares and triangles representing the two ears are superimposed. There is also no difference between air conduction and bone conduction.
There are basically two different kinds of hearing loss. In the first type, conductive loss, the problem is caused by a physical block in the sound transmission system, which is frequently surgically curable or medically treatable. In the second type, sensory neural hearing loss, also called nerve loss, treatment or surgery is only rarely possible in most cases. However, a hearing aid can help in almost every case of either type. Let us now look briefly at the structures of the human ear to understand what happened to Beethoven's hearing.
The auricle, or outer ear, collects sound and channels it into the ear canal to the tympanic membrane, or eardrum. This drum responds to sound waves and vibrates, transmitting sound to the three ear bones, the malleus, hammer, the incus, anvil, and finally to the stapes, stirrup. Remember this third bone. The stapes transmits sound to the cochlea in the inner ear. The cochlea, in essence, is both an analytic microphone and a microcomputer, which encodes acoustic signals and transmits them to the auditory nerve, and finally to the brain.
This auditory system is awesome, allowing us to receive speech, sounds of nature, and above all, the music created by a genius like Beethoven. It was not until 1798 in Vienna, when he was 28, that he began to complain to some intimate friends of some difficulty in conversational hearing.
This abnormal audiogram shows my conception of the beginning hearing loss in Beethoven's left ear. His poorer hearing is in the upper octaves. From now on, we will show one combined left-right audiogram.
If I were to demonstrate this loss on the piano, I could say that whereas before, he could hear from here to here, now, because of loss of high frequencies, he can only hear from here to here. Although he had not yet mentioned any great difficulty in hearing music, he had become aware of whistling and buzzing in his ears, technically called tinnitus. As I speak now, you will hear an annoying tone added to my voice, which represents tinnitus, an unwanted sound which can intrude itself within a person's hearing. This buzzing or ringing is usually subjective only and cannot be heard by an examining physician listening to the patient's ear. In 1801, at the age of 31, he began to suffer from colic and alternating diarrhea and constipation, and he also complained increasingly about his hearing loss.
In a letter to his good friend, Dr. Wegeler, he wrote, "I am troubled with dysentery, and Dr. Frank tried to restore my hearing with almond oil, but nothing came of it. My hearing grows worse and worse. My ears whistle and buzz continually day and night. I can say I am living a wretched life. For 2 years, I have avoided almost all social gatherings because it is impossible for me to say to people, I am deaf. If I belonged to any other profession, it would be easier. But in my profession, it is an awful state. In the theater, I must get very close to understand the actor. If I'm a little distant at a concert, I do not hear the high tones of the instruments. I can hear the low-pitched tones of a conversation, but I do not understand the words. And if anyone shouts, it is intolerable." In a letter to another old friend, Amenda, written on June 1, 1801, he said, "I beg of you to keep the matter of my deafness a profound secret, to be confided to no one, no matter who it is." Many individuals with hearing loss want to keep the loss a secret, and Beethoven was no exception. A speculative audiogram in 1801 might have looked like this, showing gradual loss in upper frequencies. The loss was slightly worse in the left ear. The progression of his hearing loss was such that at the age of 35, he could barely hear the oboes and flutes, and by the age of 42, his friends had to shout. And at age 44, his hearing would fluctuate so markedly that he could not hear at all at times.
Scientific knowledge then regarding hearing was very primitive. However, a few scientists were just beginning major research on the anatomy of the middle and inner ears.
Antonio Scarpa, the great anatomist, first described the round window of the inner ear very clearly. This work has become very important recently in my own research on sudden nerve deafness. In addition to Scarpa, among medical scientists who lived during Beethoven's lifetime, there were Antonio Maria Valsalva, Domenico Cotugno, and Samuel Thomas Sommering. However, little of that scientific research had been applied to the practical otology of Beethoven's time.
I will now begin to share with you several examples of how Beethoven might have heard his own music as his hearing loss increased.
Let us assume that we are with him in a concert hall in Vienna. This is what the musicians themselves and the audience would have heard.
Let us listen to my conception of what this quartet sounded like to him. In this simulation, I have eliminated higher pitched tones, the overall volume has been diminished, and some tonal distortions have been superimposed. Thank you. By 32, he was experiencing the isolation, frustration, and tensions common to most hard-of-hearing persons. But his was also the agonizing realization of what this loss would mean. He was defiant, however, and plunged ahead in frenzied writing and performances, working day and night.
He would escape from Vienna frequently for short visits to the countryside, which he loved, to such towns as Mödling and to the spas at Teplitz and Heiligenstadt. There, in the calm atmosphere of the country, he would rest and often compose. But he began to suffer increasingly. And in 1802, when he spent the fall at the beautiful Viennese suburb of Heiligenstadt, he wrote an extraordinary testament. In this house, really a will, which contained phrases which seemed almost suicidal. He wrote, "To my brothers, to men who think that I am malevolent, stubborn, or misanthropic, you greatly wrong me, because you don't know the secret causes. I am now compelled to face the prospect of a lasting illness, and I must isolate myself and live in loneliness. It is impossible for me to say, speak louder, shout, or I am deaf. How can I possibly admit an infirmity in the one sense which I once possessed in highest perfection? Forgive me when you see me draw back, when I would rather gladly mingle with you. My misfortune is doubly painful because it must lead to my being misunderstood. For me, there can be no recreation in the society of my fellows, no refined intercourse, no mutual exchange of thought. I must live like an exile. If I approach near to people, a hot terror seizes me, a fear that my condition may be observed." He goes on and on for several pages in a lengthy document which ends, "Heiligenstadt, October 6th, 1802. I take my farewell. Sadly, I must wholly abandon that beloved hope which I brought with me when I came here to be cured. As the leaves of autumn fall and become withered, so has my hope been blighted, and I leave. O Providence, grant me at least but one day of pure joy. It is so long since real joy echoed in my heart. Oh when, O Divine One, shall I regain the joys of nature and of human existence? Never? No. That would be too hard." But he fought this through. It was precisely at Heiligenstadt that he composed the great pastoral symphony. As a matter of fact, it was during the same period of initial intense despair that he began work on several sonatas, parts of symphonies 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8, the Opera Concerto, and the Opera Fidelio. This is a story of creative triumph in spite of suffering. He never was suicidal, and he lived on for 25 more years. His face ages and changes rapidly through his 30s and 40s, his hearing steadily deteriorating, so that by 1810, 1812, he is having great difficulty hearing music as well as speech. An imaginary audiogram at this period of his life shows a greater hearing loss for high tones, along with increased losses in the low tones. Also at this time, we clearly see an ear bone gap, which indicates better hearing by bone conduction.
His hearing is now dropped from this range to this range. Several of his biographers have mentioned that he would periodically bite on a wooden stick touching his piano keyboard in order to hear better, like this. This would indicate the probability that he had better hearing by bone conduction, that is, better hearing by direct sound transmission to the ear via skull bones. As I strike the tuning fork and set it into vibration, I can hear it in front of my ear by ear conduction, but I can also hear it on my mastoid bone behind my ear by bone conduction. Normally, we hear better, that is louder, by air conduction, but in certain diseases such as otosclerosis or Paget's disease, one can hear better by bone conduction. By 1814, Beethoven was already using an ear trumpet, like this one. He would wear a headband to which was attached the trumpet, and he used trumpets and sticks for several years during the periods when he composed at his piano, although he later complained that these had become ineffective. A number of ear conditions can produce conductive hearing loss, the most common being otosclerosis, a hereditary disease which frequently starts in the 20s and 30s. Another cause is Paget's disease, a skull disease of metabolic origin, which produces a similar stiffening of ear bones and joints in the sound conduction system.
In otosclerosis, because the stapes is literally jammed and immobile, sound cannot be transferred from air vibrations into fluid vibrations in the inner ear. Almost an identical fixation results from Paget's disease, in which the entire skull also becomes enlarged and especially very thick. This in addition to the fused and immobile ear bones.
There was no satisfactory treatment for either disease at that time. Today, we can successfully perform surgical procedures in otosclerosis, in Paget's, and in similar diseases, operations which usually restore hearing to normal.
Deaf and frequently sick, Beethoven pushed these handicaps aside in this house, and in the Third Symphony, the Eroica, which was first privately performed here in 1804, he leaped ahead into musical history. It was this symphony which marked a revolution and a liberation from past forms, thus justifying the statement that Beethoven was the man who freed music. His passion for freedom and liberty was overwhelming. In one of his conversation books, he once wrote in hard-to-read handwriting, "It is our responsibility to reject all kings from government." And he scratched out his dedication to Napoleon from the title page of the Eroica after learning that Napoleon had proclaimed himself emperor. By this time, it was already well known publicly that Beethoven was deaf. This bothered him just about as much as the actual hearing loss. His moody and erratic life was borne out by his disorderly flat, many corrections one on top of another on his scores, and by numerous changes of residence, reportedly as many as 70 in his lifetime. He had frequent but unfulfilled love affairs with various women, and many arguments with his family. He was deeply anguished by the suicide attempt of his nephew Carl, whose guardian he had been for some time. As he reached his middle 40s and 50s, he became more frequently ill physically, as his deafness was also increasing rapidly.
What might Beethoven have heard of his own music in 1824? Well, let's listen to an excerpt from the Mass in D, the Missa Solemnis, the famous Gloria. Let us first hear it as the audience might have heard it. Now let us try to experience what he heard of the Gloria through his deafened ears.
Goethe and other friends considered Beethoven stone deaf, as conversation, even with trumpets, now became most difficult.
His hearing fluctuated, but he continued to conduct, even though at times he heard only a few instruments of the orchestra. He probably felt, rather than heard, some of the music in a tactile or touch sense. His hearing is now reduced from this range to this range.
Understandably, he was now a very unstable, almost constantly angry man. Because he could hardly hear anyone, he was forced to use conversation books in which friends and colleagues wrote down questions, which he would then answer orally. Thanks to these existing books, we know a great deal about these interchanges. He quarreled with publishers regarding his contracts. He also quarreled with his sponsors, including royalty. He vacillated emotionally in a manic, depressive manner, and was the source of great anxiety to his friends, as well as to members of his family, especially his brother Johann. He would go for long walks in the beautiful paths around town in utter loneliness and would refuse to be with people for days at a time. His self-criticism became almost constant. Tragic, prematurely old man, isolated, fearful, angry, deaf, and almost constantly ill. Yet this man was capable of such soaring and inspiring creations as the late quartets and the immortal Ninth Symphony. The late quartets heralded a radical departure from the Baroque and the birth of new melodic, harmonic, and tonal forms. Well, let's listen to an excerpt from one of the late quartets, Opus 132. Number 15. Did his deafness affect his music? Yes, it did, in my opinion. His late compositions reveal new, unconventional tonal dimensions. And in his crowning final achievement, the Ninth Symphony, which embodies the words of Schiller's Ode to Joy, there is clear evidence that there were no limits to his creative genius. In this work, all previous dimensional limits were surpassed. A tragic description by an eyewitness in 1824. Describes Beethoven's attempt to conduct the Ninth Symphony in Vienna. And I quote from a newspaper report. Scarcely had the music begun before Beethoven offered a bewildering spectacle. At the piano passages, he sank upon his knee. At the forte, he leaped up like a giant, his hands and arms working violently. At first, the disappearance and appearance synchronized with the dying away and swelling of the music. But suddenly, he lost his coordination. He ran ahead of the orchestra, and now, inappropriately, he disappeared at the forte passages and rose up again at the piano passages. At this critical moment, the concertmaster Umlauf raised his violin bow and indicated to the orchestra that he was now conducting. Beethoven sat down facing the orchestra. At the conclusion, he had to be turned around to see the audience's tumultuous standing ovation. Let us listen for a few moments to this great ninth, the Choral Symphony, as he probably heard it. Now, in addition to his severe hearing problems, his health took a turn for the worse. With constant colds, loss of appetite, fevers, and no relief from medications, he visited his physician. Dr. Vavruk found abdominal tenderness due to fluid, ascites, edema or swelling of the feet, jaundice, and fever. Dr. Johann Siebert, the chief surgeon of the Vienna General Hospital, had to puncture his abdomen with large needles to withdraw several liters of fluid. repeated punctures became more frequent as his condition worsened. During the next 2 years, he continued to compose, even though his health grew steadily worse. In the winter of 1827, at the age of 57, he became terminally ill and did not respond to any treatment. A friend of the family described his death as follows. The end came after 5 o'clock on the afternoon of March 26, 1827. He had been unconscious for 2 days. His death struggles were violent. Only two people were present at the end during a violent storm. A lightning flash and a great crash of thunder aroused the dying man. He raised his clenched fist, opened his eyes, and looked upward for several seconds with a very angry expression. His hand dropped as he fell back dead. At the great funeral procession held on March 29, 1827, Grill Parzer, the famous Viennese author, memorialized Beethoven with words such as, "We mourn the fall of the flower of our country's spirit, the last master of resounding song, the heir and successor of Handel and Bach, of Haydn's and Mozart's immortal fame, has ended his life. And we stand weeping beside the tattered strings of the silent instrument." Many physicians have never tired of speculating about the causes of Beethoven's deafness and death. These include Paget's disease, lupus, disseminated collagen disease, terminal alcoholism, syphilis, and rheumatic fever. At the Allgemeine Krankenhaus in Vienna, the famous general hospital which still stands, an autopsy was performed on March 28, 1827 by Dr. Johann Wagner and young Dr. Karl von Rokitansky, who later became one of the greatest pathologists in medical history. The actual autopsy report is now lost, but all the indications are that he probably died from alcoholic cirrhosis of the liver, chronic pancreatitis, bilateral hydronephrosis due to stones, and terminal hepatic coma. But what caused this deafness? Let us speculate a bit based on the post-mortem examination of his ears. If the stapes, the oval window, and the round window were examined, they were not described. The inner ear labyrinths were vascular, a vascularity compatible with cochlear otosclerosis. The mastoids were normal. There were no syphilitic swellings or gummata, ruling out syphilis as a cause of his deafness. It is my conclusion that he probably had a toxic sensory neural or nerve deafness, plus a conductive deafness due to auricular fixation from either Paget's disease or otosclerosis. Compare the size and the temporal depressions of the normal skull with those of Beethoven's exhumed skull. A very thick calvarium with enlarged temporal regions suggests Paget's disease as one possible cause of his deafness. There are also reports that he changed his hats many times due to his enlarging head, again supporting our speculation that he might have had Paget's disease. If he were alive today, the blockading or conductive hearing loss might have been helped by surgery now in use to bypass sounds directly to the inner ear. But even today, nothing would help his nerve loss. A blockading or conductive hearing loss can occur in Paget's disease and can be improved partially by a stapes operation. In a stapedectomy, the abnormally fixed stapes is removed and replaced by a mobile prosthesis to correct conductive hearing loss. Would a successful operation have made a difference in Beethoven's career? Or if modern hearing aids were then available, would they have made a difference? Maybe yes, maybe no. Perhaps an improvement in hearing would have blocked his fantastic musical creativity. We know that he reached even greater heights as his hearing became worse. It is possible that in deafness, his genius was driven even higher by his remarkable musical cortex, his musical brain, which was now unrestricted by listening with good ears, either to his own compositions or to other contemporary music of his time. Beethoven's creativity reached its greatest heights when human communication was virtually cut off. In his totally silent world, disturbed only by his head noises, tinnitus, he was nevertheless able to soar higher and higher in musical thought. He found a cosmic language in his music, strange and different, and incomparably expressive. Nietzsche wrote that before Beethoven, music concerned itself with what the Greeks called ethos. Only with Beethoven did music begin to find a language of pathos, of passionate will. Perhaps he had to first become deaf before he could hear that still, small voice. His life is a remarkable lesson for humanity. Adversity need not hamper creativity. It is in this that Beethoven's life story becomes a powerful force for optimism and inspiration, a testimonial to the fact that a great love for beauty can inspire almost anyone to achieve. Human genius remains an extraordinary force.